We do have a teacher shortage. So many of the things that are being raised through this bargaining round require more teachers. We've got to make sure we've got enough teachers before we can actually agree to deliver those things. So we have to work our way through these things, and that's going to require goodwill on both sides.
Yes, it most certainly is. Chris Hipkins, the Education Minister. Now, let's bring in our panel, political scientist Professor Jennifer Curtin from Auckland University, Matt McCarten, unionist, former Labour Party Chief of Staff, and Kim Campbell, CEO of the Employers and Manufacturers Association. Matt, I'll start with you. What did you think of, we saw the unions and the minister, unions talking of mega strikes. This has gone up a notch.
Well, yes, but they've been extraordinarily polite. You know, you're trying to wind it up, but they're all playing very nice, right? And the problem is they've got is something which has been inherited for a decade, and all the stars are lined up, and now Labor.
Why didn't they do something in the last 9 years?
Well, because it was national, and I see that Nikki Kaye, the former Minister of Education, put out a statement saying that she supports all the teachers and they should get everything they wanted. And you think, what? You know, you were the minister for 9 years, you gave them nothing.
But it must gall.
And it's a gall for Labor, right? Now, Chris Hipkins has been very polite, right? But you are right, you must be frustrated. Everyone would be frustrated. Because, hold on, they've had nothing for 9 years. We've put more up now than they've had for 9 years, yet we're the ones who are now having to fix it. What do they do? That's Labor, sort of next name. They do have to fix it. The money... I think you've got the seat hidden right. I think that's not the issue anymore. It's that parents and the workload on teachers has just been increasing, and they're wanting time.
Yeah, but he's saying you can't have that as well as the money.
You've got to give something up. What's he supposed to say?
All right.
But he's going to have to fix those two issues.
Matt's quite right to ask the right sort of questions. And the teachers are complaining not having enough time. What on earth are they doing? On my sort of anecdotal looking around and asking, they spend a lot of time raising money. And the more I look into it, it seems to me the whole system just doesn't have enough money. Because when he's finished with this lot, he's got the universities looking for money, the polytechs are broke.
Sorry, are you saying you think they've got enough time, they don't need extra time?
No, I think they're spending a lot of time that isn't actually teaching. And probably 20 years ago, the school had enough money to run itself. Now they're out raising money. They're also doing a lot of unproductive paperwork. Now, nobody's asked the question, is this paperwork? Is it really necessary?
No, it's not.
And I think some recalibration might make a big difference to their lives. In the end, what do we want kids to do when they leave school? You know, there's some simple things that they need to be able to do. Right now, I mean, there's all this calibration and validation going on. I'm sure that it would drive you mad if you were doing it.
So
if you could get some of that out of it, it might make their lives a lot
Jennifer,
easier.
Why, is there not, surely there's some way which the government can signal that it will deal with the things that Kim's talking about, the time issues, and separate out the money and get a deal here? I can't understand why they can't find that.
Well, except it's a collective agreement, and so they only come around every 3 years, and so they have to actually get it all in the document now, even if they're not going to deliver it now. And so it sounds to me, you know, I think you're right, both sides are very polite, and we don't normally see that publicly in negotiations, but it does sound like there's an openness on the teachers' part to, if it's in the document, to do it in a staged way. So it would be good to see more recognition of time out of the classroom. I mean, it's not just just administration, it's curriculum development. Mm. What we're asking teachers to do now around ICT, the kinds of core knowledge that they need to have to stay up to date with everything that's changing and to build a knowledge economy, you know, there's a lot more to teaching now, I think, than what the...
But, you know, every other part of the world, you know, we talk about disruption everywhere we look, they are talking about increasing productivity. They are talking about rewarding the better results, the more successful people. It seems to me the union is lockstep in the past. And I just think we need a more modern, more contemporary discussion about it. It seems to me the whole system is short of money, right? And the question that doesn't... the union thinks the public are with them, and I think most people say that teachers should be paid more, me included. But if you ask at the same time, hey, do you want to have $10 a week more in your taxes? I'm not sure the answer would be the same.
Because you're right. In one sense, New Zealanders have to say, are we going to invest in education or not? You know, and it's been underfunded.
Agreed.
You know, it's been going backwards. and it's kind of the same old thing in all time. The teachers now, what the frustration is, they don't believe the Ministry of Education anymore. For 9 years, they've been talking about the extra time out from the classes, reducing the class sizes in the vulnerable parts, and they've gone, yes, yes, we're going to work on that, absolutely, you've got to trust us. They did. That's why they wanted in the agreement.
Yeah, but the teachers need to win the hearts and minds of the public, and I'm not sure that, are they doing that?
Yes, when it's explained, there's more expectation on teachers. We've got families now, you know, in our generation, one-income families. Both parents work now. More pressures on teachers to cover all sorts of things which weren't covered
in the past. Social issues.
That teaching was a profession, you know, a cooperative profession, not a man-eat-dog, you know, I'll get ahead of my colleague. You know, you do work in a cooperative environment. You can't say this teacher is good and this teacher is bad, because it depends on what kids you have, what years you're teaching, when does that thing. No country in the world they do any of that. It is actually, it's about the status of teaching, the resourcing, and the community support for it. It's just not another cost. You've got to say, is education an investment or is it a cost? And I know that Chris and the government's got a limited spend, but it is about priorities. And I've got to say that parents in the country, if you said you didn't have to go and raise the cake stores, you know, if you cut teachers were teaching, they had the professional development.
But how much of it?
You
got some political considerations here. If they give too much to the teachers,
yes,
do they then run the risk of the next?
But I'm saying is, I think most New Zealanders, if you say what is the most important contribution to government debate, it's education.
Sure.
And then I think it's health.
After health.
And I
want to bring Jennifer here, because there is a political consideration. I mean, we can't ignore that. They must be thinking, we're first year Labor government,
the cops were offered more than
too much to the teachers, it's going to be a problem for us with other sectors.
I don't know if it's too much. I think they'll want to get it solved. I mean, I'm not really sure that this government would want a mega strike in term one next year. So it really is going to take more meetings. I do think that there is public support. We know from election studies that education is really important. So I think actually taxpayers for things like education and health are okay about paying a bit more tax in order to get quality education.
But do you think giving the union a blank cheque here is actually going to solve the problem? Because they're going to be back in 3 years' time with a similar problem. We need to find a way of sorting this out once and for all. What should teachers be paid relative to the rest of the population? And what work should they be doing? Bearing in mind, I was really interested to see these special needs teachers coming into the system. Because it seems to me that the teachers are not only expected to be teachers, they're also psychiatrists.
Absolutely.
Because our mental health service is underfunded.
Absolutely.
And so a lot of people who in the past perhaps have more mental health assistance are now in the schools, and the teachers are having to cope with that as well.
Sure.
We need to sort this out.
Sure, but in the same time, we know that there are large chunks of New Zealanders not even getting a pay rise this year. And if they do, it's 1.5%, maybe 2%. And teachers are being offered something much, much higher than that, possibly $10,000.
3%, 3%, and 3% to catch up from what they haven't been getting. The top ones have had a freeze for 9 years. Right? That's actually, so yes, the money's important things. What used to be in our generation is that kids went from school, got paid to go to teachers' college, come out without a debt, and went straight into a job and guaranteed to get a job. Now it's just the market.
All right.